And welcome to Never Seen It Film Club, the film club where we watch films that you've never seen. I'm Emma Bainbridge, and joining me today from Cinepunked is Robert J. Simpson. Today we're discussing Submarine, the 2010 Richard Ayoade classic.
I was crying earlier. My eyes are probably red.
They look fine.
No, well, maybe they don't go red when I cry then. Le monde entier. It's really rude to leave the film before it's finished.
Me too.
To the filmmakers.
How are they gonna know?
They just do.
How?
They do.
How are you feeling today? Are you feeling very 80s nostalgia?
Yeah, do you know, it's so I haven't watched this immediately before I did this. I last kind of saw this a couple of weeks ago because I was getting ahead of myself. I've seen it before a couple of times, and it's a weird one. It's not so much the 80s nostalgia thing that I feel, but it's just that empathy with what it is like to be a teenager trying to navigate a world where your hormones are changing and life is changing around you, and you're kind of understanding stuff and you don't quite fit in.
Yep.
And you're trying to find your tribe, which actually is the tribe that isn't your tribe.
Yeah.
So all that stuff I kind of resonated with me, although with the caveat that my upbringing involved a single sex secondary education. So that kind of element of things was the fantasy. I mean, yeah. You know, like, what's it like to have another gender in the classroom? I don't know.
Yeah, that was always our thing. Same thing, like the good old Northern Irish grammar school upbringings and like single sex, where our biggest thing was like a boy would come in and be like, it's a boy.
A boy.
Oh, like we'd never seen one before. Like it's, you know, apparently people have them and out and about in the world, or so I'm told, but when you're in a girls' grammar school, it's like any inkling of testosterone, you're like, oh, hello.
Hello there.
It's a strange thing because, I mean, obviously with here, for me, it was always tied in with sort of senses of sexual repression. And the film is sort of a voyage of sort of sexual awakening of sorts. And there's that fear in Northern Ireland that, you know, if you stick children of opposite genders in the same space in their adolescence, they're going to do things to each other.
Leave room for Jesus.
Ignoring the fact that if you stick kids of the same gender in a space, they're also going to do things to each other.
So,
you
know,
homosexual fast dancing.
You know, just everyone can't quite work out what's going on. So, you know.
I think that's what's really nice about, I know there's like kind of back and forth about Submarine, like being, is it pretentious? Is it this or is that? But as you said, I think what's really nice, it does have that kind of, the narration in it does speak of an older person reflecting on their teenage self and kind of remembering it for what it was, like it's awkward and it's this, and I thought I was so cool and like I was of this tribe and I'm just reflecting on myself in this window. And like the what I really love about Oliver's character is when he's kind of narrating himself on the beach and he's like, this is where there would be a crane shot, but I can't afford it, so you're getting this one. And I'm like, because in my head as a teenager, as someone who loves films, I was always like, if this was a film, I would like be wistfully looking out and then there'd be all these cool things. And then I was saying to you earlier, Granny would whack you with her shopping and then very, very quickly bring you back down to earth, which I think is amazing. But yeah, I think it's really interesting what you're saying about the kind of up and down and the ever-changing nature of everything, because you've got his relationship with himself, his school life, his love life, and then his parents and their love life, and then everything. So it's like a very tumultuous kind of thing that's going on.
Like I think it's very authentic in terms of how it represents that too, because I mean, when I think particularly about the relationship that he has with parents and how he understands their relationship and what's going on with them and the temptation that his mother is faced with when a handsome ex, played by Paddy Considine, comes back into town. Like I can think about how I would have thought about those sorts of things as a teenager and how black and white I viewed the world at times and how like there were things that you kind of wanted to do and you felt different about, but you still had a very simplistic, often, I felt I had quite a simplistic morality that as an adult, I can see a lot more kind of gray in, and he's sort of navigating that. And I think, I mean, Jordana's doing it too.
Yeah.
She's in flux. They're both in flux.
Yeah.
And they kind of, you know, what attracts him to her, I think, is part as he sees a kindred spirit. He thinks they're on the same kind of path, but actually she starts to deviate mm-hmm. from that. What's that line? He gets worried because, you know, when her mom gets cancer, you know, she's going to go all gooey in the middle
yeah.
because of the life experiences, and she will no longer be the cool, kind of hard, yeah. You know, fetishized person that he wants.
Yeah, I think that's, I think when you're a teenager, like, your aesthetic is so much of your identity that you're like, any string of that, like, in your own head, completely messes with your worldview. It's that thing of like, when you see a happy goth, I'm like, that's not allowed. And that to some certain extent, when you see that kind of relationship with Jordana kind of changing with her own life path, as you just said, going one way, and then he's like, but you're deviating, you're supposed to be cool girl.
Yeah.
Like, cool girl wouldn't do that. And then his kind of coming to terms with his expectancy of someone else who doesn't quite mesh with his, as you said, black and white worldview.
There's something quite hypocritical about him too, though. I mean, there's a point at which he, there's the girl, Zoe, mm-hmm. who he participates in a bullying exercise yeah. with and drives to the point of despair, and she leaves the school because she's so upset. And then he has the audacity to mansplain about how, you know, what she should do in her life in order that she is no longer bullied by other people.
Yeah.
But then we get the reveal later on that actually the first person he ever kissed was her.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in terms of his own relationship with those sorts of things, in terms of his own journey, in terms of sort of the simplicity in the black and white, there's a complexity there that mm-hmm. he's not, either he does understand it and he's just not prepared to admit it because there's clearly a public and a private face.
Mm-hmm.
Or he's just not seeing it because he's still at that age where, you know, he can't, I say at that age because that's wrong though, because I know plenty of people who are a lot older than that who would feel exactly the same way. We'll, you know, hypocrisy just is lifelong, I think.
Yes. Well, there is that element of like, it's, you can't do that, but you've just done it. I'm like, but it's okay if I do that because outwardly I am doing exactly what I should be. You don't pay attention to the grey bits of my life because I'm not portraying that outside. So don't even try and come at me. So it is that there. Well, there's one rule for me, but there's not one rule for you. But I'm behind the camera, like I'm the voyeur here. I'm playing by the rules. Don't you look beyond that kind of thing? I think with Oliver, because I think that's used kind of as a metaphor quite a lot. Is that he's the viewer, the voyeur of life, and then he doesn't like to admit that he's participating.
Mm.
In a way that he wouldn't respect if someone else did,
mm-hmm.
which I thought was quite interesting, as the hypocrisy of a teenage boy being like, you know, I don't care for all that kind of stuff, but then, you know, in his own way, being like really romanticizing the whole relationship with Jordana, and like, mm-hmm. it's not soft and gentle in the way that we've seen Roman, but like it's his version of that, and he can't help himself. Like the whole kind of performative aspect of her seduction, where he's like, we're having dinner because we're grown-ups, and then I've got candles, and then this, and I'm going to lie on the bed. And it's like, there's a certain bit of his brain that goes, well, that's how it's supposed to look, so I'll do that, but it's...
Their whole relationship is off-kilter from the start, because yeah. it's her really that starts the seduction of him.
Mm-hmm.
And she's very much in control, and the way that she goes about that is staged for the cameras.
Yeah.
And there's this element where, I mean, you're aware, you've already pointed out that mm-hmm. this is a film that he's kind of narrating, like he's looking back on his life. So he's the narrator of his own film. This is his story. He's in some respects an unreliable narrator because mm-hmm. we're seeing it from his point of view. Is he editing this in a way that sort of suits him better,
mm-hmm.
that suits his narrative better, that suits his journey better? I don't necessarily think so, because he still seems quite naive and ignorant about a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But that point where she literally, you know, gets him to meet very, very ominously underneath the bridge. They're kind of sitting there, and then, you know, she gets her to kiss him and takes all the photographs.
Yeah.
Like, wonderful selfies.
Yeah.
But it's all staged, and then she proceeds to, you know, there, that's being staged, that evidence of that relationship is going to be put somewhere
mm-hmm.
in order to avoid any questioning of his sexuality,
yeah.
which instantly is questioned.
Yeah, that's it.
You know, I actually watched that clip again just before I came out tonight, and I mean, the sort of the shock, but also the eerie familiarity of the chants of Gaylord.
Yeah.
I mean, that certainly felt like my youth.
Yeah.
You know, you did anything that was at all different, and that's what people shouted at you.
That's it, yeah.
But you know, it's complex, it's curious, but it also feels very adolescently genuine.
Yeah, does that choppy changing of style, so you get that kind of Wes Anderson style in shot of them going very fast back and forth, very Rushmore when they're in the hallway. They've got these like long, beautiful landscape shots, and then you've got these more intimate kind of moments with his Super 8 film where he's like, cool, this is what I want it to be, and it's all kind of chopped up together. And that's how I remember like scrapbooking and stuff as a kid. Mm-hmm. Like you do things that feel right, and like that's why I think that it feels genuinely adolescent, because I'm like, it's got this kind of nice growth pattern to it where it's like his sight evolves and his opinion of the world evolves, and it's reflected in the cinematic style that's going through the shots, which I really appreciate.
Do you think it's pretentious?
A little. Uh-huh. I do think it's a little pretentious, but I don't think there's anything wrong with that, because I think I knew Boys Like Oliver, and I'm like, they are a little bit pretentious, and that's fine. But yeah. I also think there is something quite sweet. I think the relationship he has with his dad, and that lovely scene where his dad kind of brings him a mixtape, and it's like, you know, and he's like, this is music that I used to listen to, and it doesn't come out of nowhere. But it's kind of like a nice kind of snapshot of, oh, this is why he cares about the marriage so much. Mm-hmm. It's like, this is the dad he knows. And especially in British cinema, we don't kind of get that kind of insight into family relationships as nicely as that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where it is. But it is, to me, a little pretentious, but it's just because I think as soon as someone has a style that's not... Sean Meadows, I think everyone gets called pretentious, and like, oh, it's got a little bit of Truffaut in there, so it has to be pretentious. But I'm like, yeah, but it's kind of cool and indie. And I think looking back on it now, I think at the time I was definitely its key audience, because it came out in 2010, so it was like bam smack in the middle of me doing a film story screen going, oh, Submarine, you haven't seen it, well, I can't talk to you. But reflecting on it now, it's actually quite a nice collection of what was kind of cool at the time and and that kind of way. But
I kind of see it as part of a history of these kind of films. I mean, I was thinking about this today, and I mean, every time I see any images from it, anytime I watch, particularly Oliver, is I think of Harold and Maude.
Yeah.
He is Bud Cort, and Harold and Maude, it's just that he's not shagging an octogenarian. spoiler alert. Seen Harold and Maude, best bit, but you know, and that's not the best bit, the whole film's great. But I think it is definitely evoking that. You've also got this sort of obsession with death that's prevalent in it, including false deaths and imagined deaths. There is this kind of finding relationship and kind of evolving and kind of working stuff out. But the other film I thought about today was If. I don't know if you've ever seen Lindsay Anderson's If. It's set in a public boys' school, so it's slightly different. But again, there is that blending of sort of adolescence and the fantasy and reality. And the thing about Submarine is, I think the fantasy pretty much is a reality, with the exception maybe of his own imagined, well, what would happen if I died and everyone would love me and miss me and they will have a big service for me and I can rise Jesus-like from the grave. But aside from that, I mean, most of it seems to be real. I don't take any of what we see as being... a false memory.
It's funny. I was kind of thinking of other similar films that, because to me it feels very kind of 60s in its kind of portrayal of adolescence, which I think is great. But there's some elements and definitely some shots remind me of Gregory's Girl. No, it's not like,
oh gosh, I haven't thought about that for years.
It's not like super like jaunty like Gregory's Girl is, but it has that kind of honest portrayal of like the slang and the kind of raucousness of teenagers. It's not overblown, because I feel like there's the Skins effect, where people go one way too far in their portrayal of adolescence, where they're these drug-filled, mad, sweary hell beasts.
You tell me that wasn't your adolescence?
No, as I said, I went to a girls' school. I was very well behaved and was not at the venue underage at all. Maybe a couple of times. But that's what I kind of like. It's like, it's not too extreme. So that, like, the bullying scenes, it's realistic. It's not anyone being gunned down with, like, an AK-47. We're not America.
Got him!
The subtlety of, like, stealing a bag and, like, throwing it around. And that kind of shenanigans out, but that's kind of what it reminded me of, is like those little
Grange Hill.
Yeah, that's perfect. Yep. Swansea, Grange Hill. Swansea, Grange Hill.
The thing that bugged me watching it this time was my awareness that it is very male heavy. Mm-hmm. And she's almost fetishized, Jordana's Yasmin Page. I mean, she is, that's her purpose. I get that. And I get that whenever you're an adolescent, if you like somebody of whatever gender, the adolescent kind of voyage of discovery and first love and first attractions, it can blinker out everything else. Mm-hmm. I completely appreciate that that is a thing that happens.
Yeah.
But it strikes me as being slightly odd at the moment. But maybe that's because I'm watching it in 2022 and I'm very, very aware that even in the last decade, I was going to say that we've moved on a bit and that, you know, we are trying to be more inclusive in our films and that the gender mix of casts is a bit more balanced, but actually it's not really.
No, it's not. It's why one of the things that gets me is that you notice when it isn't, because films like Booksmart get hailed as like amazing new things, and I'm like, it's a very good film, Booksmart's, I'm glad it exists, but again, it shouldn't be, it's got two female leads and they're teenagers and they're not popular girls and they're not doing this and this, they're normal. It's like, that shouldn't be out of the blue. It shouldn't have to be Booksmart. It should be more, as you said, more mixed. But I think there's a certain amount of quota filling in modern films.
So who's this for? I mean, who is this aimed for boys or girls or both?
Well, see, being a lonely teenage girl,
yeah,
I definitely would identify with Oliver. Like, it's one of those things, I don't think of him as a teenage boy, which is strange. I think of him as like an agender loner. So, because I definitely could apply things that happen in this film. I'm like, it doesn't take much push from my imagination to be like, oh yes, that's very reminiscent of something that happened to me. Mm-hmm. Maybe the opposite away. Like, as you said, the kiss scene, I'm like, been there. Like, let's go to an isolated place. Let's do this, but maybe not take selfies, because then it definitely proves that you are the gay that they're screaming about in school, which is not ideal.
I don't remember my first kiss. But that's the thing. I mean, it's the things that this film kind of reminds me of. I mean, mm-hmm. Their first sexual experience being kind of anticlimactic. Mm-hmm. I don't remember at all. I mean, it's kind of, I'm vaguely aware when and where it happened, but I don't remember a thing about it.
Yeah, I think that is one of the, well, I think that's why it doesn't strike as reminiscent with a gender. It's an audience for loners, or like the other kid, the weird kid, the JDs of the world. Heather's reference, spoiler alert for next month's film.
You're not a rebel. You're fucking psychotic.
You say tomato, I say tomato.
All of us who were kind of indie kids and like into the slightly weird music, into the slightly offbeat films, weren't quite in the right crowds for things.
Yeah.
Because our lives weren't super mega party. So when things happened, like your first infatuation, at the time it feels really intense and like it burns. And then when you look back on it, you're like, oh yeah, it was just the other weird kid in the room. I think that's who this film's for, is like the weird kids in the room.
I mean, I have to ask, just because I'm very, very aware about kind of the male gaze.
Yeah.
And being the male in the room, like, I have to kind of just check about like, how is this being appreciated by somebody else? I mean, am I reading it wrongly? Am I meant to empathize with it and somebody else doesn't get it? Or is it actually a universal story? Which, I mean, it feels like it does, but it's, you know, this is the stuff that I recognize. I don't know if that's...
Yeah, no, I fully appreciate the question, which I think is great. But yeah, I think in Submarine's case in particular, it is very non-male gazy. Even because I know we're talking about his kind of relationship with Jordana and his kind of fetishization of her in his head almost, but it doesn't feel that way as a viewer, because it's not typical male gaze. So it's not, you know, the slow pans up her leg and she's not like super conventionally attractive, and it's not this, but it's also not Zooey Deschanel in 500 Days of Summer, like, I'm the quirky girl.
Yeah.
I'm here to be quirky. She's not that either. So I think while it could be seen as like, you know, she is the only kind of main object of his affection for most of the film, and like the thing he has his most attention on, like she feels like her own character, mm-hmm. which is very, for me, in the kind of typical teenage films, it's not. She's usually just an object, whereas you don't get that. So I think that's why it feels like a more universal kind of a film.
What about the parents? I feel like we can't have a conversation about this without addressing the parents in some way, because that relationship and the relationship he has with them seems as important as anything else. And actually just the relationship with parents.
Yeah.
Plural, because also his relationship with Jordana's parents, which sort of comes out of the blue, and then her relationship with them. Again, it's all very kind of complex, but it says a lot probably about growing up.
Yeah. I think the especially when you kind of look at how he addresses just his mother in general, it's never a blaming thing. It's always from a place of empathy that he's talking to her. It's never a typical anger teenage thing. It's like he doesn't quite understand everything about the complexities of his parents' marriage, but he doesn't blame either. It's not like a blanket, you're an evil whore, you're burning in hell. It's like he's desperate for that to be, for her to understand just how much his dad actually does want, he wants it to make it work as much as they do, like his dad does. And it's not just because he doesn't want them to break up, it's because he has the empathy to know that, you know, there was a love there once. Like there's things about both of his parents that need to be together, and in his head it makes sense.
I find it at times uncomfortable, because for me, he talks to her and about their relationship almost like his father, you feel, should be talking about it. I mean, he's very, very frank about their sex life.
It is.
Disturbingly so. And then, you know, there's the him watching from the hall, which is very unnerving, very kind of creepy, very voyeuristic. And then there's the revenge that he enacts on the lover, where he goes in and conducts, as I saw described, minor acts of violence. I mean, he tries to set fire to the house.
Yeah.
Well, literally the bed, which is obviously where he imagined that they were copulating together, even though it transpires, you've seen the film, so we can have a talk about it. Even though it transpires that she just gave him a hand job in the back of a van. But that strikes me as being, that's the reaction you expect from the husband. It's not the reaction you expect from the child.
Okay.
Is it? I mean,
I'm like, that's probably very, it's almost kind of Oedipal in that way, I guess.
Completely.
Yeah,
I mean,
like he's a surrogate for his dad's pain.
It's like, you know, he talks about like them wanting to work, and it's just like, it's, I just find it very, very odd and very disturbing, and I'm just kind of intrigued how other people feel about that.
Well, see, that's interesting, because I'm like over here being like, oh, it's really nice that he's so empathetic, and you're like, he's a dangerous psychotic, like imprinting himself as his father's double and acting in his place, but...
He's a creep.
Yeah, I mean...
I'm just going to be honest. He's very definitely creepy. I mean, even down to write his love letter that he writes to Jordana after... Which he writes... before they have sex.
Okay.
I mean, he writes that, he has that all prepared, because he gives it to her, you know, kind of ahead of time, before they've done a thing. It's all sitting there, it's all ready to go. So he's not even reflecting on a lived experience. This is him writing a letter that he thinks he should have. Although I was reading some reviews on Letterboxd earlier, and there was somebody talking about how they wish that their boyfriend had written them a love letter like this. I'm like, I mean,
maybe this is where the difference of the genders is.
It could be, but I will quote his letter to you, because it, just to remind you just how creepy this is. So Oliver says, "Dear Jordana, thank you for letting me explore your perfect body. I could drink your blood. You're the only person that I would allow to be shrunken down to a microscopic size and swim inside me in a tiny submersible machine. We have lost our virginity, but it wasn't like losing anything. You're too good for me. You're too good for anyone. Sincerely, Oliver." I mean, apart from the inner space reference, which I quite like, I'm assuming that's what it is. It's before time?
I don't know, because see, to me, this is maybe where the kind of the agenderness of this, like, I remember things like this happening, like with my friends writing letters to their boyfriends, like in their heads, or like on LiveJournal being like, even ahead, be like, oh, he's, you know, thank you so much for being a part of my life. This is amazing. And, you know, you're everything that I could want in a boyfriend, and like your body and that kind of thing.
Before?
Yeah. Like before they've even met people, this is the thing. This is like...
I find that weird.
Well, I am like, unfortunately, of the millennial generation. So we had to do a lot, like the amount of fan fiction that have been written and read in my lifetime because people, you know, couldn't get out and about because we all got the internet very suddenly. But beforehand, like just even in like, messaging, I think it's just a sext.
Well, I mean, I'm sitting here thinking, listening to you talking about that, and I'm thinking, like, is that what we're kind of, I mean, because I am aware of online dating. Bless, I have no choice at this stage of my life. I have to. But I'm aware of people getting really, really involved really, really quickly. And also some of the weird, creepy messages that some of you send. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know which one it is, because I know right now it's someone sitting there going, I know I probably shouldn't have sent that. If you're thinking you shouldn't have sent it, you shouldn't have sent it.
Yeah.
But those people who kind of get really, really involved really, really early on, who send the love letters on their, you know, their first three texts, probably accompanied by a dick pic.
And then they ghost you.
Yeah.
At least he didn't ghost, but no. He does ghost her.
He totally ghosts her. He is a modern man ahead of time, because whenever the shit gets real, he buggers off. Mm. For someone who says that she's too perfect for him, who cares so much, the moment that she's allowed to have any kind of emotional response for herself, any kind of, agency, he vanishes. And then he gets pissed off because she lives a life without him.
That's true. Yeah. That's the modern love story.
I feel quite emotional.
I get it. It is that thing of like, that to me feels a bit beyond its time, which I think is really good, because that does sound so modern. It's like, you know, give. And then as soon as you kind of get to know someone for real, you're like, nope, I'd eat her. You're not what I thought. Goodbye. It's the Instagram effect, where it's like, Instagram is perfect, and then you see someone in real life, you're like, nah, not for me. I'm buggering off. Bye. He's not a dog person. That makes me sad. But no, I don't know if I find him creepy, but then again, that might say more about me than it does about anything else. Because again, very sheltered girl school brought up here, where to me, Oliver Tate would have been like mysterious and cool and, oh, he's so like... blah, 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 blah. But then, as you said, rightly pointed out, he's just a typical asshole man who buggered off as soon as anything happens. So.
I guess it's a very human kind of story. It's a human condition, and the responses they make are very human and realistic, and stuff that I think generations will recognize to greater or lesser extents. There's always that thing when you're watching a film, like, if it's a good film, I project myself into the characters when I'm watching, and I think probably most people do, and I definitely see elements of my own messed up, inadequate, slightly repressed and confused adolescence within him, and what it was like whenever a girl actually took an interest in me, and kind of, you know, anyone took an interest in me, it was kind of bizarre. Still feel like that. My 40s, you know, I recognize that, and then I kind of go, well, I mean, but then I think about my own situation, about self-esteem, and kind of like thinking, you know, like how that reflects on. I guess I'd like to see how Oliver got on 20 years later. Like, you know, did he have girls locked up in fridges in his basement,
or did he become Dennis Nielsen and do the same thing, but with? Is this whole anti-gay thing just a whole closet metaphor? We'll never...
Is he anti-gay, though?
No, I don't think so. I think time-wise, because it is the 80s in Swansea, I'm like, I think gay would be the worst thing you could be called. And I think to him, it's just the ultimate negative. But actually, down the line, do I think Oliver Tate would be homophobic? No. I don't think so. He couldn't afford to be if he's into French cinema. that's the only people who like to talk about it. So, but there's good and bad in everybody, but I think Oliver definitely resonates with me as a character. Like, I think it's interesting because it's 12 years on, because it's 2010. God, 2010 was 12 years ago. But it does hold up as a film. I think it's just as interesting now as it was then. Again, I think the lens of the world's obviously changed quite a bit since then, and as you were pointing out earlier, you know, would it necessarily be made the exact same way these days? I'm not sure it would, But is that necessarily a good thing? I don't know, because it's nice to have that kind of snapshot of, because it is of that time period, it is stylistically, but then also the 80s, it's reflecting of Swansea and that kind of bleak Welsh coastline life. I'm like, that deserves to be encapsulated and kept and like thrown into the world of like, this is how it felt. You know, 30 years ago when it was cold and miserable and the only thing you could do is listen to your tape and your dad's a weird marine biologist that can't describe himself and your mum's having an affair with a weird guru guy who's showing up in town and all that kind of thing. But I think there's definitely elements that everyone can attach to. It would be interesting to see the response to it in another 10 years' time as we go on in life. But God bless Oliver Tate. I mean, I he's a creep and he's a weirdo, but I would definitely hang out with him. I grew up in Lisburn. Like, the real ones know the bandstand. We all know people like Oliver Tate, but they were all 30 years older than him, and he's definitely the lesser of two evils. So I would definitely... Teenage Emma would have gotten on with him quite well, I think. Although he wouldn't have gone near me. That's sad. I'm just the Zoe character, but anyway. Yeah. But I think the style choice of having Jordan in that big red alert coat for the whole thing as well is quite interesting.
I just think it don't look now, the whole way
that's
through.
That's literally it. It's, like,
it's the bleakness as well that feels like the opening. I don't look now, or, you know, and the whole journey through Venice. Like Venice, when I was in Venice, it was gorgeously hot and sunny, but Venice in that film is so
terrifying.
Bleak. And there's this little red coat, and that's all I think of with her.
It's literally it. I'm like, was that, because in my head I was like, were they going for like a red riding hood? Were they just going for a big glaring obvious girl sign? But in my head, I'm like, they're going to turn her around and it's going to be a Venetian short older lady who's going to stab Oliver Tate in the face, or is she's going to drown him, or she's going to do something, because that's all red coats do to me now, is make me think of that.
Well, she definitely would stab you, and she is involved in the pushing of Zoe into a pond. I mean, I don't know if there's a deliberate don't look now thing going on. I'm pretty sure there is.
Yeah, I would say so.
I mean, Richard Ayoade would probably never you know, be you could play with you too much if you ask them that directly, but I'm pretty sure it's there. But also, like, again, if I'm thinking about things like the films that it evokes for me, things like If and Harold and Maude, I mean, and then Don't Look Now, I mean, it's all 70s, late 60s, early 70s cinema.
Yeah.
And you talked about Truffaut.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, that is very definitely a stylistic era. And it probably are the things that he's influenced by and that he loves. And that's okay. I mean, to be fair, it is a kind of, I mean, red's a warning color. It's it's also the color of love.
Of passion, but also danger, World War II.
Red flags. And she definitely waves a lot of red flags.
Yeah.
Although, I gotta be honest, I mean, you would have hung out with Oliver. I probably would have hung out with Jordana, or would have wanted to hang out with Jordana. I mean, even watch something like, I can see all the attractive qualities here.
Yeah.
And I know that they are bad attractive qualities.
Well, yes, but probably would have both gotten our little teenage hearts broken.
Probably, possibly something else. But yeah, I mean, yeah, there's definitely a warning, and she's a strange character, but she has a heart.
Yeah.
She's just a gooey center, so it's okay.
But all in all, I do think it holds up as a film, and I think it's Ayoade's first feature film.
It is.
And... Well, I remember at the time there was a lot of debate whether he would be able to pull it off, because obviously he comes from a TV background and a shorts background, but I do think like it's nicely cinematic, and I think he does a really good job as a first-time director of probably putting way too much of what he wanted to do in there, but I think it's good. Like it does feel like his first time directing, he's going to put, as you said, everything he loves into one film in case he never gets a chance again. So it's all those 60s references. It's all those kind of late 60s, early 70s cinema references that he's like, get it in there. But what I think is interesting as well, I think it was his director of photography. I think it was his DP's first feature film as well.
Right.
And it is a gorgeous film.
Oh, looks stunning. Yeah.
And I think...
Technically, it's not a film I could fault, even with its bleakness. I mean, as much as you want to sit and watch a bleak film for an hour and a half, it's a good bleak film. And I mean, I don't know that I would say he's trying to cram all his references in. I mean, I've read his books as well, and I mean, he's got plenty more references in that head of his. But it does feels like that DNA, that stuff that you've learned is just kind of sitting there, and that's the language that he's turned to first. But it still feels distinctive enough Like, I know people have kind of talked about being pretentious and kind of Wes Anderson-y.
Yeah.
Yes, but Wes Anderson himself is a refinement of other influences. Mm-hmm. You know, and over time you can see how Wes Anderson has become increasingly Wes Anderson, mm-hmm. to the point where it's its own kind of thing. Rushmore is not, you know, like Grand Hotel Budapest. They're there's a lineage, but they're different films. And I think, you know, if Ayoade was making more films, we would definitely see his style progressing.
Yeah, I would agree. Okay. I'll take back everything I just said.
Yes.
No. I didn't. Yeah, I do agree. I think it is a shame that he hasn't been able to do as many, because I think mm-hmm. he's really interesting as a director, and I like his vision for things. And I think he's got a very interesting perspective. But yeah, the good thing is that he won't Wes Anderson, because French Dispatch was too Wes Anderson. It was a Wes Anderson film that Wes Anderson way too hard. It's the Tim Burton. I say it a lot to like people who don't really like cinema as much as I do, and it's like it's the Tim Burton effect. I'm like, there's always going to be one film that pushed it too far, and it was Willy Wonka for me. So it's like French Dispatch has Wes Anderson too hard and into the future. But
I kind of love both those films.
And on that note. What would you give Submarine out of Submarine? Like on a scale of wandering into the ocean, fantastic bleakness, to I'll just not dip my toes in.
Oh no, it has me wanting to go into the sea. I mean, good. You know, I want to go into the sea with them. I would like to continue that journey.
Cool.
I might even consider taking a Polaroid of myself when I have a snog.
That is some. But thank you so much for joining me, Robert. That's been a really lovely discussion and really interesting. So I might rewatch it again, and like, not immediately, because I do feel like quite good place at the moment. I feel like if I watch it twice in 1 week, I might not feel so good. But it's definitely given me some interesting things to talk about. So thank you so much.
Pleasure.
And thank you guys for watching. You can follow Robert at Cinepunked on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
Yeah, we're on Facebook and on Twitter. We're Cinepunked Film on Instagram. Thanks to somebody else having taken our name.
Yeah.
Hate you. So you'll find us in there. Or you'll find me as well separately as Avalard. Avalard.
Awesome. And you can find us at Accidental Theatre, and we're Accidental Tea on Twitter, because some bastard went to the theatre. It's always something. And you can follow us on Instagram, and we will be back next month with another discussion. Bye, guys.